start at 8 and no one here, and at 2 minutes to 8 there would be one person or maybe a couple. Yeah, it's a couple, but it's two people. So the fear of actors are, especially theater actors, are that there is no audience. You have so much to say, so much to perform, and then there's nobody here. So I'm very happy for each one. Grateful you're here. And also I'm very grateful to be in Zimbabwe, in Harare, and in this incredible place as the guest of Vivian, who has been an incredible hostess. So in front of Rinpoche and everybody, I want to say thank you for all the fights and the laughs we had in the past couple of weeks. It was fantastic, and it's continuing to be so. So the idea was that my idea when I wrote here, saying I was coming and wouldn't it be nice if we had a fire and we would all sit around it and everybody would tell their stories of Rinpoche. That was my intention in the beginning. When I came, I was told that wasn't going to happen because not so many actually knew Rinpoche or knew him as intimately enough to tell stories. So I was in a quandary, what am I going to do now? But as some of you who know me know that I am never, never out of words. So there will be words. That's a good thing. But what I decided is Rinpoche in action, Akong Rinpoche in action. Do you all know who is Rinpoche, Akong Rinpoche? Do you all, you just know, or you say no, no. Okay, Akong Rinpoche, very shortly, Akong Rinpoche is the founder, was the founder of Rokba. Akong Rinpoche was our teacher, our guru. Some of us, a very, very wise man who connected compassion and wisdom most skillfully. And you would think that that is somebody maybe a little bit boring because it's also holy and so good, but the opposite is true. He also had an enormous sense of humor. Sometimes I didn't understand it, especially when he told jokes that were funny in Tibet. And yeah. Then what happened? Right? That's the end of the story. But in any case, he was he unfortunately was killed in 2013. And I had had the great privilege to be with him and work with him, to be happy with my teacher, and also to work with him building up Rokba. In 1979-80, we went on pilgrimage together. Many people, 20 or 22 people went on pilgrimage, and I was very, very lucky to be allowed to go with him. And at that time, I didn't really know him. I hardly knew him. And we went to India and Nepal. And being Swiss, this is the first time I ever encountered real poverty, you know? When I didn't have chocolate and I didn't have money, then I felt like I'm really poor. But there, and in Switzerland, at that time, we didn't see any beggars. You know, that has changed with all the refugees. But anyway, I went there and I was really deeply shocked to see the extent of poverty and leprosy and little girls carrying their own babies and holding out their hands for bakshish. It was just, it really, really broke my heart. And out of great selfishness, I decided I had to do something, that acting was not going to be my life. It couldn't. Because in acting, you have to be constantly concerned with yourself. How do I look? How is my hair? Well, obviously not great. But normally, then you would run to the hairdresser and make sure that it's perfect. How is my body? You know, I need to lose weight, I need to be slim, I need to be beautiful, I need to be blonde, I need to be perfect. I need to be whatever I'm not. And that was my life for about 14 years. And going to pilgrimage totally changed my life and my way of thinking 100%. Because these images, whenever you've seen the images, you will live here, you live with these images here. You know, we didn't. then they never left my head, and I decided there and then I am going to dedicate my life to do something useful. Because again, in theater, for every part that I want and may get, there's 20 others who look more or less like me. And we sit in a room and everybody, we wait to audition. And you look at the others and say, hell, you know, she is much prettier than me, you know. Hell, you learn tricks like, you want to audition, you want the part so badly, and you learn tricks like taking peanuts with you. So everybody's nervous, you hand out the peanuts, and everybody, oh, thank you so much. Mm. You're the only one who doesn't eat peanuts, so when they audition, and you learn tricks like upstaging people. How do you do that? Gradually on the stage, even if it was rehearsed differently, you move back, slowly back. So the person who talks to you has to turn back and look at you. So the audience doesn't see them. They have wonderful display of emotions. But they see you, you're standing, you're going, ah, oh, whatever, you know. So you have a stop. So that kind of mindset of constantly worrying about yourself and displaying yourself, gradually it didn't work anymore with the other images. Anyway, so I went to Akong Image and asked him, would he help me start something to help people? And for a year and a half, I think, he totally ignored me. And some of you already heard this story, so I make it quite short, but for you, maybe others, he totally ignored me, and I was so outraged. How could he? He's a high lama, he's very important, he's giving teachings, he's someone we all look up to for humanity, for compassion, for kindness, and he denies me, he decides not to help me, when I want to help people and be a savior. But later I understood. He was testing me, was seeing how long would I do that? Would I come back a few months later and decide, oh, I've gone back to the theater, now I want to be a movie star in Hollywood. And a year and a half I did it on my own, and then I came back and asked him again, and you know, we who are connected with Dharma and have taken refuge, we do three prostrations to the Lama. So I did my prostrations, and I was shaking inside, and I was going to ask him the third time around. And if he says, you know, three times is like a magic number. If he says no again, then I'm lost. What am I going to do? And he was reading a text, and he was, so he was not giving me any attention. And here I was prostrating, he wasn't looking, he didn't see how elegantly I did it. And then when I said, will you do this charity with me? Will you join with me to help people in need, please? And he just said, okay. That was all the drama there was. So here we are. And then we built up Rock by the Charity over the years. Then we went to Tibet for many, many years. Until his death, and even after that, four more trips I did on my own. So I'll reconnect to the beginning when I hadn't planned to give a talk. So I call it Rinpoche in Action because I chose, just for you who don't know what I've been doing here, so I'm checking the projects here, the Rockwell project, the charity project, and going nearly every day to another place. So there wasn't really big time to prepare something splendid. But in my memory, whenever I didn't have the time to prepare splendid things, they became splendid. And with the preparation, they may not be so. So I'm hoping for splendid today, you'll tell me at the end. So I thought, how can I talk about Rinpoche? How can I bring him close to people who haven't known him? How to do that with a person who is inexplicable, who has so much compassion, and his mind was 360 degrees. Mine, hopefully, is 20 to 30, you know? His was, and there was never a a limit to everything. You know, I was with him for all 40 years. As a student and as a co-worker and under him as the learner. And I never stopped to learn from him. And I never got it right, never. I always thought I played the game with me, with me because we traveled a lot through Tibet and there were many, many hours in the car, sometimes 16 hours in one day. And then we get to a project and then there would be a dinner with lots of official people and all you want to do is crash. But then I would play the game and then many, many people wanted to be with him and I needed to move back. And I used to play this game with myself of, now he's going to do this. Now he's going to say this. I've known him by then for 20, 25, even 30 years. Surely you know a person by then. Forget it. Forget it. I don't think I got it right even once to predict what he was going to do or say. And in that connection, I want to read something to you. Normally I never read things out, but today I will. I've got a lot of quotes because I do not want only to talk about my own connection with him, but I want you to experience him as he was. However, I wrote this piece, this little piece, and it will explain him so, I think, quite clearly. So it says, it's called Letting Our Goodness Shine. Because of Rinpoche's very unique depth of understanding of human nature, he encountered each person as a human being first, and as a Chinese, a Tibetan, or a European or African later. And my feeling is that this made all the difference. There never was a bias that you could feel that this is the Chinese authority, this is a Tibetan monk, or this is my personal brother or nephew or my child or anyone close to me. The way we all experienced him was the way he related to us. He related to me, that is only the only case I really know, but I am sure it applies to all of us. Not, now this is important, not as I perceive myself, but in terms of my potential, where my potential lies. So he addressed my potential rather than my actual state of being. Thus, if I was in a total mess and angry or negative or sad, he did not relate to that part. Even if I tried to make him relate, I'm sad, then just, that time, nothing happened. So that's how I've understood after 30, 40 years that he relates to the potential. He always seemed to relate to the person itself, to whatever goodness there may be in me, and thus making it possible for that goodness to shine, and making me wish I could achieve my potential in order to prove him right. It felt like he had to be right. So I did everything I could to be the person that he possibly saw in me as a potential. It seemed to be my Buddha nature, which he addressed. And that was a personality which I had never been acquainted with. Buddha nature means the innate goodness that we all have. Every animal, every human being, every person has it. But it's so hard to find it and to be convinced of it. I didn't know this was in me, but because of the respect for him, I definitely tried to become a better person. Like all of us, I think all of us felt like that. And I think that probably it worked the same way wherever Rinpoche went. That when he went to meet an official, it was very harsh, or very decisive. I'm talking about China, where the officials still have that kind of sense of authority and everybody bows to them and accepts, even they don't agree. So when he met an official who was very harsh or very decisive, or had a certain job to fulfill, Rinpoche totally respected that person's situation, that person's duty. And somehow, through his going beyond the title of the past, task of the person, he looked beyond into that person's heart and found a human being rather than a Chinese, a Tibetan, or a European, or an African. He saw a human being and he allowed that human being to respond to it, which is love and kindness and wisdom. one of many descriptions you could give him. And I think it is something that is important for each of us, I know it's important for me, to remember that again and again, that even somebody irritates me or doesn't do what I expect, you know, what I expect now. We were talking last time in the retreat about thank you, you know? You give somebody something, you expect a thank you. When you don't get it, it festers in the mind, doesn't it? I gave that person, they didn't say thank you to me. What kind of person is that? And before you know it, that person is in a negative, you see the person in a negative view. Later, maybe 3 months later, you meet them again, and you can't even remember the exchange you had, but you do remember. There is a kind of an imprint in your mind. I don't think I like that person. You don't even remember why. And he did it the opposite. It's the potential of goodness that he saw. Anyway, enough. Let's watch. So I chose a few clips that I have on my hard disk, and they are not in a specific order. So we'll just see what comes up, okay? No, I can't even read this.
No, just a minute, sorry.
Oh, it's gone.
No. There we go.
Oh, it's coming back. Oh, wait a minute, what is this? No, that's not it. Come on.
Temple Talk by Lea Harare, 27, I guess.
Where does it say that?
Yep.
Oh God, I'm too close, I think.
You can come here.
Let's do the first one. No, oh yeah, let's do the arrival, yeah. And then maybe just go from one to the other. We'll see how much time we have.
Diamond crystal.
This is how you will arrive at the project. Do you have any sound?
Yes.
Because he was in Switzerland, a seer. He met Rinpoche in my house, in my flat. And he told Rinpoche that, that he had seen in his vision on a holy lake outside of Lhasa, he had seen a letter R in Tibetan. You all, most of you know what the letter looks like. He had seen the R. And after long research of years, he found out that the R is exactly the same, the way it was written, as it's on Rinpoche's seal. He found that through the internet. And anyway, they met. They even went, Akong Rinpoche said, if his holiness Dalai Lama says this is genuine, your vision and you are genuine, because many people have visions and talk, so, then I will do this. And they went to seek his holiness Dalai Lama, and he said, yes, here's the right thing. So Rinpoche took on the project. And he said to me, I need you to fundraise for Guru Rinpoche. We're going to build, on the vision, it was 9 Guru Rinpoches that needed to be built. So we needed to have the first one built, which then became this one in Jodrak in Yushu County, in Kham, in East Tibet. And I said, yeah, okay, fine, good idea, lovely. How much would that cost? What? $250,000. My jaw down there. How would I do that in Switzerland, where everybody is Christian and, you know, some Jewish, and there are very few Buddhists, and I mean, who is, and then to build something, when we have a charity where we ask people to save children from the street and from starvation, and, you know, and oh, I was in a panic and absolutely out of, you know, I was just really panicked and very scared. How am I going to do that? And Rinpoche said, as he said a few times over the years to me, if it's meant to happen, it will happen. He kept on telling me not to worry. He actually told me it was a Jewish disease. And he said, if it's meant to happen, it will happen. Then he also said, you always think it has to do, and I said, I already have so many projects to fundraise for, and how can I do that? And I had a very small team at the time, and I was the only fundraiser. So anyway, you can imagine, this is a big thing. So I said, okay, let's do it. And another thing he said is, you people, not just me, but you people, you always think it's you. That is why you get worried. That is why you get upset. But this is your karma. If it's meant to happen, it will happen. He said that many times about himself as well. When I said, how are you going to do that? How are you going to achieve that? How is this going to happen? Constantly worrying. He said, if it's meant to happen, it happens. He said, I rely on my karma. So I believed him. And that is the beauty of having a guru, having a teacher, is that if it's someone like him, that caliber, that incredible wisdom, then first you start to think, oh, you know, who knows? But after years of experiencing that every time it happens, as he says, every time his wisdom and compassion are so palpable, you start, even though your natural self is to worry, you start to unworry and unwind and say, okay, if you say so, then 9 of them, 9 times 250,000. And so what can I say? I started to ask people, and somebody gave me £50, and somebody gave me 20 Swiss francs. I thought, if it's meant to happen, it'll happen. And one day, a donation came in, suddenly, 50,000. Well, francs and dollars are nearly the same, so 50,000. Cool. He's not in our data, what do you call it? Not in our database. A man, nobody knows. We have no clue. I called him to get excited. 50,000, the first, the beginning. And no words of where the money should go to. If somebody gives that kind of amount, they would say for women in Tibet or for children in Nepal or something, nothing. Just freedom. I called Rinpoche. I said, this is what happened. And I expected him to say, wow, right? I was stupid. He just said, yeah, okay. That was the end of that. He knew it was going to happen. So we built the Gurumich in here. And that was the big, big celebration, the first Gurumichi. And until Rinpoche's death, we managed six of them. We're still waiting for three. We're still, I don't get a visa anymore, so 2013 he tragically passed away. And I went every year till 2016, and then my visa was denied. They didn't enjoy foreigners to come to do good, you know. Anyway, that's another story. Let's watch the second one. Maybe stop this one and let's watch the second one. The Tibetans were always very, very excited to see him, and so many people came. What is the next one? Just continue there. And somebody needs to stop me when it's time to stop, because I'll go on till tonight. Yeah. Rinpoche was aware of climate change and ecological problems long before it was in the news and on Facebook. In the 80s he started. I mean, he may have started long before, but in the 80s he talked about it. Yeah.
Indian food with
champa?
Sampa.
Champa is
that? What is sampa?
Champa is barley powder.
Yes.
It's like this state of diet, like you have many meal here. Champa, they grind it into powder with the barley, and then they put it into this cup that we showed. And they add a little butter, like you said, and tea, butter tea, salty butter tea, and this cheese that you can't chew. You know, you take one piece in your mouth, chew it for 24 hours. And then they have it in there, and then they go like that, you know, really beautifully, with a hand, which is not washed, and it's totally fine. And they make it into little bumps or whatever you call it, and then they flick it into their mouth. And the old people can, because you don't need to chew it really, it dissolves, and it's 100, and that's all they have, butter tea and sambal. That's usually what they have. And if they're very lucky, they have a bit of dried meat, and because Tibetans don't believe in killing, although they are killing, there is meat, because it's so high, then there's no vegetable growing, you know, so they have to. But then, you know, they'd rather kill a yak, which is a huge animal, than, you know, little animals. So it's only one death rather than many. And then they do all kinds of prayers before they eat and so on and so forth. So if they're lucky, they have a bit, and then at some places where we went, high up in the mountains, that they would bring a yak leg, which is like starting from here, and it comes, you know, it's like, you can imagine, this long. So it comes on the table and everybody takes out their knives, which is not the Swiss Army knives, it's this very big one. And I don't understand why they cut it this way rather than that way. So they always think, you always think they're gonna cut, but they know how to do it from time to time. And then they chew the cheese and that, and chew, and no chocolate, no chips, no nothing like that. But this he did, as I told in the retreat, he did again and again in different places, that he asked people to gather all the rubbish and the glass and the thing for one week or one day to just show to people. This talk was given to our students in one of our schools, but also there was a group that time of Western people, so that's why he did it in English and so on. Anyway, I want to intersperse, I'm glad we have 3 more hours. I just got a few quotes, so I'll say a few quotes and then we look at the next clip. He said, because some people said, well, he has a family, he's a wife and he has 3 children and an adopted son as well, who is the son of his sister in Tibet. And somebody once said when we're sitting together, you're traveling all the time and you're going around and all that. What about your family? Don't you have to look after your family? Then he said, it is not that I'm not interested. And I was constantly writing. I was writing and writing over 40 years. I was writing down things that he said. So now, and he often said, don't write down, keep it in your heart. But my heart obviously is not big enough. So I had to write it. So he said, it is not that I'm not interested in my family, but there are only 4 or 5 people. I go to where the numbers are 20 or 30,000, people who are dependent on me. I go where I can be of most benefit. That was really his life, 100% genuine. Then of course, as you know, he said, only the impossible is worth doing. And I think Nelson Mandela said, it's impossible until the first person actually does it. Then he said to me, don't think I'm helping. I said, oh, I'm helping these people. Think I'm serving people. Then he said something, just be like an artist. You do every day as best as you can that day. And in the end, the whole painting is perfect. Then spiritual charity should not have any question about whoever it is wanting help. As soon as you investigate, charity becomes artificial and is no longer spiritual charity. Which was very useful for me because I'm doing charity all the time and giving food to people and all that. And of course in the first years it has thought, what does he mean? You know, he's got a nice shirt on. He may have money to buy his own food. Sorry, I'm just using this example.
Sure.
And then he said, you don't investigate. It's not your business. You know, we have a soup kitchen. We still have a soup kitchen in Nepal where since 1990, where people can come, anybody can go and get food. And in the beginning, I felt, you know, people are giving money sometimes who don't have much money, but they're still generous. I must make sure that only those who really need it get it. Well, he said, that's not your business. And strangely enough, I was afraid that 10,000 people would come. Strangely enough, as much as our land contains, that's how many people come. And if it's not enough, then they wait and they come again and we make enough food. And it always works. And we always have more than enough. So that's Akong Rinpoche's influence. And then he says, and then we go to the next diamond. He says, if you want to do charity, you have to be like a rock. That doesn't mean you are frozen. You have to be hard, even strong. Only think of one thing to help. You should have one thought to help, not to be dependent on others, what others say or think. You won't care if you are rejected or beaten. So if you beat me up after this, the next one is what? Which one is it?
Birth place. And then
no, you don't have to do that. Do an interview, yeah? Sorry, I'm not sure about that. That was my feeling that, you know, how much more time do we have?
It's,
well, you know, officially it's
no, never officially. Unofficially, how much
time? I know, okay, how much time do we have? Do you have?
10 minutes?
No, another 10 minutes. Okay.
Then not this one. Mm-hmm. Let me do this only one then two.
Someone takes a fee.
What? No, show the... Oh, this is very hard for me. Show the Bible orphanage. Yeah. You have to invite me again.
Oh, yeah, with pleasure.
This is a bit, go back, sorry. It's so hard to really choose, you know? I always want everything.
But they're all fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you've seen Tibet, so I want to show you. Do Nepal soup kitchen. No, the one up, yeah. Children to put them to school, or to our children. school. But nowadays, not so many left.
It also says interview with image, interview with image, so I'm not sure.
It will be good.
Oh, I do want to show you this. This is again in Tibet. Wait a second.
Rinpoche started the school, the first one, for Tibetan children in Tibet, in Yushu, and directed it from every time when we came there. Connected, he's so good connecting with people. And these children grew up with him coming every year. And they love, I mean, they're all orphans and all from very poor family. And over the years, they made such a close connection, and they saw him as their father that they never had. And you know, I wrote a piece, anybody interested, I can send you. I wrote a piece about his visit, the typical visit, where he checks everything, and we check the books, and we pay the money, and all the usual blah, blah stuff that you have to do. But then comes the moment when he sits outside and relaxes, and the kids are all over him. He sits on the floor, not on a high throne, not on brocade, as he would in a monastery. He just is the dad of his children. Mm-hmm. And they're all over him. They love him so much. And I just, in brackets, I can't help myself after all this. I have been to the inauguration of a monastery in Sichuan. And the Chinese write in English. They call Sichuan S-E-X, S-H-U-L. And they gave me an umbrella as an opening gift. And when I saw Rinpoche sitting on the ground with a strong Tibetan sun on his head, and he didn't have a hat, I quickly ran to my room and I brought the, oh, I have an umbrella, I brought the umbrella. And then the children went, no, I will hold it. And then I tried to take a picture of that. And the way it was turned, there's Rinpoche, that big on the umbrella. S-E-X,
yeah.
But the children didn't care, of course. And then what they do there is that in the night, this is their favorite moment, because in an assembly room, they bring chairs, like easy chairs they have, and very old and decrepit, they bring them together to make a bed for him. And every child runs to their room, it's already dark, and Rinpoche is already about to come, and they get a cushion. I want to give my cushion. No, I want to give my cushion. I bring my blanket. I bring my teddy bear. I bring, I don't know what. I don't think they have teddy bears, but I bring something anyway. And then they make him first sit and then lie there. They want to keep him all night. He stays there till 2-3 in the morning. He gets up again 5 or 6 in the morning, and we go on with the project. But that was their night. And then, it's totally before they had all their costumes and they do their dances and they're very official, but here this is their evening with him. So suddenly somebody comes forward, a little girl comes forward to sing, and you know they screech when they sing. For us it's, you know, terror, but for them it's beauty. And always they close one ear so that they can sing. I don't know why, but anyway they do that. And then you see that little girl, so embarrassed, but really wanting to give him an offering. So she does like this. And, there we go. And another one, they have a skit about a farmer, a nomad, trying to sell a yak to somebody, and then fighting and shouting at each other. And Rinpoche sits there laughing and laughing and laughing. Anyway. There's such a feeling of warmth and beauty, and they were so sweet to often include me in the gathering and so on, and also so of course we knew each other for many years. Now they're graduating, and we met again at a party, and this is the graduation. You see a little bit of the graduation party. The children who know that he's looked after them since they were very small. Yeah, go ahead. They have started to earn a little money. All of them are doctors. We educated them. All are doctors. And every year I made about a couple hundred photos of him that he could hand around. So precious for them.
Tibetan doctors.
Tibetan doctors, all of them. The whole school was to train Tibetan doctors from small. And they have known him by then about, but now they're all, well, now this is their graduation. Other people wanted him to be the drinking partner, and he didn't shy away from, he would manage to drink a glass of whiskey with any of them, In China, in Tibet, there's these big round tables, and there'd be 20-25 people at a table. If somebody wanted to bow down and say, "Hi, Lama." Bless my child. then you would listen to him. If somebody said, there's a 456, he'll go there and he'll try to see what is wrong, because he's also a Tibetan doctor. And so he was always what people wanted him to be. And he responded. I mean, it's impossible to describe. Mm-hmm. It's just impossible. And I have another 20 clips, and I have pages and pages for women to print out for me, which I didn't use hardly at all. But I think maybe it's enough. I don't know. You know, if you want, then I come. I'm still so young, so I will come. I can promise you that I will come the next 20 years every year.
Wonderful.
And I can, no?
Yeah. 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 All right, cool. Thank you very much. I leave it up to you to organize if there is something to organize. Okay.
And I hope that you know Rinpoche a bit better and that you have something. What did Donald say? What, something to take away?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.